Good morning, and happy Easter to all of you on this beautiful day. It is so good to see all of you. So exciting. We're going to begin with the Easter song, so I invite you to stand in body or in spirit as we sing the Easter song. And Diane is so excited.
Ringing, they're singing that we can be free again. Hear the bells ringing, they're singing Christ is risen from the dead. The angel upon the tombstone said he is risen just as he said. Quickly now, go tell his disciples that Jesus Christ is no longer dead. Joy to the world, he is risen. Alleluia, he's risen. Alleluia, he's risen. Alleluia, alleluia. Hear the bells ringing, they're singing that we can be free again. Singing Christ is risen from the dead. The angel up on the tombstone said he is risen just as he said. Quickly now, go tell his disciples that Jesus Christ is no longer dead. Joy to the world, he is risen.
Sound awesome.
Hear me once my audio comes on. Yay! Welcome, everyone. Welcome on this incredible Sunday, Easter Sunday. Christ is risen. He is risen. He is risen!
He is risen indeed!
All right, welcome everyone. My name is Pastor Jason. I welcome you in the name of the one who has overcome the world, including death itself. Welcome to the United Church of Christ Congregational of San Luis Obispo. Our mission here in our church is to love, to do justice, and to walk humbly with our God. God as we understand God. Our purpose is to enhance and to strengthen our personal, not private, relationships with God through the teachings of Jesus. I welcome everyone here in the sanctuary this morning and those who are joining us from home. It might be later that they're able to join the service because we're having internet trouble this morning. Oi! Oi! Anyway, welcome everyone joining us from home. It is a blessing to be with you all today, and I invite everyone to join me in singing Christ the Lord is risen today.
Christ the Lord. Tongues and
Seated. All right. Welcome, welcome, everyone. I'm going to invite us to move right into who and what we are grateful for this morning. If you have someone, something that is filling your heart with joy, raise your hand and Kathleen will come around. Yes. Welcome. Oh, sorry, Austin. You're happy for Easter. All right. Yay, Easter. Let's see. Yeah, James. Welcome, Matt. Yep. Welcome. Welcome. Let's see. Can we get microphone number 3 on? How about number 4 then? Because we can't hear folks very well. Colleen. Okay. Welcome, Michael. Welcome, welcome. Let's see, more gratitudes. I see Ashley up here at the front, and then Peter after. Yes, amen. Welcome, Margaret. Woo! Yeah. Oh my gosh. Kathleen, let me check out that microphone. Maybe it's user error. The green light is not on, is it? Okay, let's switch it to number 4. Perhaps it is the batteries. Vielleicht. All right. Let's try number 4. Number 4. All right. All right. Margaret.
I'd just like to say that I'm very thankful to be here and so appreciate all the love and affection that has been sent to me and my family during this time.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
Yes. Welcome, Margaret. Okay, and then Irene and Peter.
Hi there. We're pleased to tell you that we're leaving this afternoon on a trip to Uganda, and we'll see you in the middle of next month.
All right. All right. Safe travels. Safe travels. Okay. I've got a few gratitudes to share with you all.
I got one, too.
You have one, too. Okay. How about you go first?
Okay. Yeah. I'm grateful for this warm weather.
Warm weather, yeah. Kathleen, if I know one thing, I know that you do not like the rainy weather. Yeah. All right. I've got a few gratitudes to share. Number 1 is you might have noticed the beautiful lilies And I want to share how grateful I am to Joanne for picking them up and bringing them to us on Monday. Our church is full of folks who do things behind the scenes that we don't even know about. I don't even know who does half the things around here. But I know Joanne brought us these beautiful lilies, so thank you, Joanne. Thank you. I also want to share that Christy and I had a great visit with Jim and Jean Webb this week. And Jean and I text all the time, and she texted the next day and said, "We're still beaming from our visit with you and Christy yesterday." So they send their love, and I will share our love with them.
I have a gratitude.
Yeah, go ahead, Roz.
I am so grateful for these gorgeous calla lilies.
Yes. Yes.
Who got them and put them here? Aren't they beautiful?
Yes, they are. Yes, they are. I'm super grateful for our musicians. You know, the holidays are always a challenging time for church musicians. Yay! Yay! And then I also am grateful we have an update on Spirit. Spirit is the New Life Canine that we have been sponsoring. And Spirit is now with a family down in Southern California. Mom is a nurse who worked in the emergency room all through the COVID-19 pandemic. And so Spirit is now taking good care of her and her family. And so, Spirit, we hope we see you again someday. Gosh, we love you, Spirit. I think we have one more announcement from Shannon.
You're supposed to hop.
Yep, it's on. It's on. Number 4.
Number 4. There it is. Hi, my name is Shannon Babcock, and this is my wife, Heather. As the new ministers of education, we'd like to invite the tweens and teens to stick around after service today. You can join us in this large room next to the altar, and your parents can come with you or head to Nosh for fellowship. Our short discussion will deal with the topic that Pastor Jason will cover in his sermon, so make sure to pay attention. And afterwards, we'll head outside to see if we can find some very special Easter eggs for the big kids. All right, thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you. All right. One of my favorite things to do as the pastor of this congregation is to welcome new folks into this community, this growing community. My goodness, if I had to count, I don't know what I would do this morning. It is so great to see all of you, and it's great to be able to welcome into Covenant 12 folks today. So, yeah, I know. So I'm going to call them up one at a time, or one family at a time in this case. And we'll start with James Babb. James, come on up. So let me introduce everyone to James. James has lived on the Central Coast for 60 years. Wow. I think you got most of us beat. His hobbies and interests include working with his 3 sons, one of whom is here this morning, maintaining their cars, cycling, sailing, skiing, and whitewater rafting. What brought him to our church? Tammy Newcomb invited him to church about 3 months ago, and I think you've been here every Sunday and Wednesday and Thursday since. Something you might not know about James. He likes to rescue sad orchid houseplants and bring them back to happy blooming for their caregivers. Oh my gosh. Welcome, James. Welcome. Yeah, you can go ahead and sit down. And so in each of these bags, we have a history of our congregation that ends abruptly in 2008. Ooh. We'll get to work on that. We need to interview some folks and finish writing the rest of the story. Now you know the rest of the story. So anyway, there's that, there's a current directory, and then there's also this pin, which is a comma. And the comma is a reminder that God is still speaking. Never place a period where God has placed a comma. God is still speaking. So, at this time, I invite Colleen to come forward. Colleen, welcome, welcome. Let me introduce you to Colleen. She has lived here in SLO for 6 years. She is semi-retired and enjoys water aerobics, hiking, dancing, watercolor painting, traveling, and learning to play the ukulele. All right. There's room up here. She came to this church partially out of curiosity and also by being impressed by the activities in the parking lot and the messages and quotes on our street sign. That is the hardest working piece of signage here in San Luis Obispo. She also has a few friends who are members and heard good things about this church. And then something that you might not know about Colleen is that she was an attorney for 30 years, and she worked in Alaska, Wisconsin, and North Dakota. She's licensed in all three states. She has taken several bar exams. Yeah. Welcome, Colleen. Welcome. Yep. All right, I'm going to invite Cindy and Stacy up now. Come on down. Welcome, you two. Let me introduce Cindy and Stacy, and I'll start here with Cindy. Now, Cindy is third generation born and raised. Okay, now I think you have all of us beat. Yeah, in SLO, here. Her hobbies and interests include snow and water skiing, hiking, horseback riding, communing with nature, fly fishing, and traveling. What brought her to our church? Well, I'll just share. Her direct experience during the church remodel was so positive. She was introduced to a church that literally practices what it preaches. What we preach also aligns with her way of living with the world. One thing you might not know about Cindy is that she is the co-author of a manual on surviving mold illness. Fascinating. Welcome, Cindy. And then Stacy. Stacy has lived here since 1996 after having moved 13 times and living in six states. She was ready to stay put. Her hobbies and interests include snow and water skiing, cycling, hiking, horseback riding, movies, traveling, and spending time with friends. What brought Stacy to our church? Well, she has been interested in finding a church for a while, especially one that was open and welcoming, but had not actively pursued it. When Cindy suggested that they try this church, she was all in and has no regrets. What's one thing we might not know about Stacy? In 2019, she rode her bicycle 545 miles from San Francisco to LA every single mile in 1 week to help raise money for AIDS research and support. Thank you. Welcome, you two. Welcome. All right, Hawthorne family, come on up. Come on up. Yeah. Welcome. Welcome. All right, I'm going to start here with Mo. Mo lived in SLO while she was attending Cal Poly, and then she moved back with her family in 2021. Her interests and hobbies include foraging for mushrooms, spending time with her family and dog, and cooking. What brought her to our church? She was looking for an open and affirming church. And then something we might not know about Mo, she doesn't like to follow recipes. Good for you. Good for you. All right, and then Dad here, Rob. Rob was born and raised in SLO. And then he lived in Portland for 17 years until 2021. He enjoys hiking, kayaking, architecture and design, building, and spending time with the family and the dog. What brought Rob to our church? Well, his boys getting the book, What is God Like? By Rachel Held Evans on our first visit, and also the motto that God is still speaking. The book, What is God Like? By Rachel Held Evans is one of my favorite books. And then something you might not know about Rob, he met Mo on their first day of college at Cal Poly. Oh my goodness, oh my goodness. Wow. All right, and then I have Theo here. Theo moved here with his parents in 2021. Yeah. His hobbies and interests include soccer, reading, piano, and cello. Hey, there's room in the band. He likes that our church is active in the community, and he also likes Roz's cooking. Something you might not know about Theo is that he enjoys escargot.
Ooh.
Whee! All right. And then lastly, Gabe here. Gabe moved with his parents in 2021. He enjoys soccer, tennis, and Legos. Legos! He likes the music here, especially the drums. And he has a dog named Peppa. Yeah. Welcome. Welcome, family. Yeah. Welcome. Yes. And then the next person I'm introducing actually asked to join our church toward the end of last year. She joins us from home on YouTube, and that is our dear friend Nancy Rye. Several of us in our congregation know her. I see Marlene clapping. Nancy is a fellow Kiwanian and a retired educator and one of the dearest people I've ever met. She and her husband Steve moved here in June of 1996 when Steve retired. Her hobbies and interests include reading and making cards. She likes basketball, go Bruins, and golf. And then what brought her to our church? I think the folks that attend here. And then also she belonged to the first Christian church in Reseda, California, which is part of the Disciples of Christ. And then something we might not know about Nancy, she loves blue, including my blue guitar. Also, that they went to the Philippines as Peace Corps volunteers, taking their three girls with them, and they served there for 4 years. Welcome, Nancy. Welcome. All right, and now I'm going to call up Laurel Smith. Laurel was not in town when the rest of her family joined back in December, but she's here now. So let me introduce Laurel to everyone. She has lived here in the area this time for 35 and a half years. Her hobbies and interests include Labradors, reading, writing, and then also her beloved doggo, Betty, and her grandson, Austin. What brought Laurel to our church? The same thing that brought the rest of her family, Austin. He woke up one Sunday morning and said, "Let's go to church." And that's it. Here you are. One thing that we might not know about Laurel that we would have never guessed is that she's introverted. And describes herself as a little bit shy. I never, ever would have guessed. Oh, my goodness.
I'm sweating right now.
Oh, Laurel. Oh, Laurel. Oh, my goodness. Welcome, Laurel. Welcome. Penny, come on up. Yeah, Penny. Penny Warner has lived here for 1 year. Her interests and hobbies include helping others, education, and travel. What brought her to our church? Well, the wide open doors every Sunday, very inviting, and finally she walked right through them, and I think you've been here every Sunday since. Yeah. And then something that we might not know about Penny, well, I knew this about her, but you might not have known, she is a change agent. Penny, welcome. Welcome. And then Jim Wright, come on down. Jim Wright has lived in this area for 1 year. His hobbies include hiking, birding, astronomy, photography, reading, and eating too much at NOSH. Yeah, I do that too. I do that too. What brought Jim to our church? Well, he was introduced to our church by his dear wife, Tina, and has been drawn since by all the love expressed by this church. One thing you might have not known about Jim is that he has visited all of our national parks, excluding some way out there in Alaska. Someday. Welcome, Jim.
Welcome.
So I have a brief covenant to ask you to enter into. James, Colleen, Cindy, Stacy, Mo, Rob, Theo, Gabe, Nancy, Laurel, Penny, and Jim. We are the descendants of people who came to a new world looking for religious and political freedom. The Congregationalists desire to live in a country without a king and worship in a church without a bishop. They believed that local congregations were capable of making decisions for themselves. They desire to govern themselves and discern for themselves God's mission for them. So, I ask you now, will you be in covenant with God and one another? Will you live in awareness of God's presence in the world, in your neighbor, and in yourself? Will you continue Jesus' mission to love, serve, and heal here in San Luis Obispo County? Will you support this congregation with your service, your presence, your prayers, and your gifts? If so, everyone say, we will. Then in the name of our Lord Jesus, I welcome you into this congregation. Welcome. And before you leave today, I need everyone to sign the official church roster that we have been signing since 1959, I believe. Christy, maybe you can help everyone sign the roster because Dodie's going to be busy today. Because we have lots of kiddos here. Speaking of kiddos, I have got some of my favorite things for our kiddos before you head out, and that's jokes. Oh my gosh, I love jokes. You know, one of my favorite theologians, his name was Karl Barth. He thought that humor revealed the heart of God the way serious academic theology just can't. There's something special about humor and being surprised that reveals our living, loving God. So, here's some jokes. How does Easter end? With an R! What kind of bean can't grow in a garden? A jelly bean! Why is Easter breakfast so fun? It is. Everybody's cracking yolks. What's the Easter Bunny's favorite restaurant? IHOP. What happens if you get married on Easter? You live happily ever after. How does the Easter Bunny travel? It does, by hairplane. All right, here's the final one. What kind of bunny can't hop? A chocolate one. Oh my gosh. All right. Kiddos, you are a joy to all of us. And I invite you now to head out for a brief lesson, a craft, and then I think you all have an egg hunt. Yeah, I've seen some eggs hidden around here. So, young ones, I invite you now to head out that door. And I'm going to invite Jana up to lead us in our call to worship and our opening prayer.
Let us all stand together in body or in spirit for our call to worship. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Hope is alive.
Hope is alive indeed.
God's love is eternal.
God's love is eternal indeed.
Please join me in the opening prayer. Loving God, we come this morning with eager anticipation. Open our hearts that we might experience you anew. Open our lives that we may be faithful witnesses to Jesus' resurrection. May we share your steadfast, liberating love to all people everywhere. Amen.
Rise, let darkness fall, let all the earth join heaven's song. The death of death, the end of fear, joy to the world, the King is here. The King is here.
Amen. You may be seated. Before our time of prayer and meditation, I have a reading from the book of Acts. and I'm going to read it from a very special translation. It's actually more of a paraphrase, and it comes from our good friend Jason Cans. I think several of us in the congregation are friends with Jason, and he is a neuropsychologist, and he has the most adorable hairless cat. And they have the same hairstyle, if you know what I mean. Anyway, he has rewritten, paraphrased the New Testament from the point of view of God writing to all of God's beloved children. And it's a really refreshing way of reading it. So this is from Acts chapter 10. Peter cracked a smile and said, "Truly, I believe that God does not show favoritism. It does not matter where you are from, when you live your life pleasing to God, and you view God with holy reverence, God welcomes you." Beloved, Peter's belief was still maturing. Allow yourself to continue growing by my Spirit's activity in you. I know that you have heard rumblings of the good news that God sent to Israel, that peace is available to everyone through Jesus. You have heard what Jesus did throughout Judea, starting in Galilee, how his cousin baptized him, and that he was the anointed one, imbued with the power of the Holy Spirit. After his baptism, Jesus ministered throughout the region, doing good and standing against evil. He healed the sick and the oppressed. God was with him in all that he did. Peter was summarizing all the things they had heard about Jesus. People shared the news by word of mouth, and Peter wanted to make sure they were on the same page. Messages can easily get distorted through word of mouth, so hearing from the source is beneficial. Peter continued, "We were there. I saw him do all these things about which you have heard. He ministered in the countryside and the city. We also witnessed the Romans put Jesus to death by hanging him on a cross, but God raised him to life 3 days later. He did not appear to everyone, but those of us God chose as witnesses. We ate and drank with him after his resurrection. He instructed us to tell people about him and his kingdom, and let people know that he is the one God appointed as judge over all creation. It is this Jesus about whom all the prophets wrote. Listen, everyone who believes in him is forgiven and welcomed." Peter wanted them to understand what they heard about Jesus was no mere myth. It was objectively true, and he was an eyewitness. He wanted them to know that they were welcome with Jesus. Amen.
Look for me.
in us, sorry, around us, God, the new life in our relationships, in our world, in nature. We thank you for all of these new signs of hope. And we pause now to think about these signs that we have seen. We ask you, God, to comfort all of the individuals for whom this may be a challenging time. We ask that you give them peace, reassure them of your belovedness. We also ask, God, that you help us be mindful of those things inside of us that are resisting the new life that you envision for us. Help us discover what stands in the way of an even greater thing that you have in store for us. Help us surrender these attitudes, beliefs, habits. We know something even better is awaiting us. We lift up now, God, the people that are so important to us. The people we carry with us this morning in our hearts, in our minds. And we ask you to restore them in whatever way they need restoration. We pray for Jen, Sammy, for Kay, for Lisa. We pray for Marcia Coffey, for our first responders and veterans. We pray for the Webbs as they pray for us. We pray for Sage Cooper and family. For Michael and Terry, for Morris and Ray, Gordon. We pray for everyone undergoing medical treatment, everyone grieving in this time, God. Be with each of these people and the others now that we name or lift up silently in our heart.
Kenny, Sierra, Kendra, Taylor, Trinir, Sandra, for the Crum family in Florida, for our country, for Mayor Michael Brady and his family. Carol Whitaker.
We thank you, God, for each person in our life. We thank you that you call us each by name, a name that resonates with us like no other, one that reassures us of our belovedness. Loving God, we lift up all of these prayers in the name of the one who overcame the world and said, "My peace I give you, my peace I leave with you. We pray the prayer he taught his first disciples using the language that is most meaningful to us. We pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Taken from John 20, 1 through 18. For those in the sanctuary, you can follow along on the screens or on page 882 in the Pew Bibles. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciples, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciples set out and went towards the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed, for as yet they did not understand the scripture, that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? For whom are you looking?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, 'I am ascending to my Father and your Father, and to my God and your God.'" Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them that he had said these things to her.
Thank you, Jana, and thank you for being our liturgist today. This is Jana's first time being a liturgist, and she picked Easter Sunday. Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh. Thank you, Jana. It's hard to imagine the amount of grief that Mary Magdalene was in at this moment that John describes. When Jesus called her early on to be his disciple, she gladly accepted the opportunity. She had been part of Jesus' inner circle from early on. She'd been there the whole time with Peter and Andrew and some of Jesus' family members, notably his mother Mary and his brother James. Now, Rabbis didn't call women to be their disciples in this time. They just didn't. Women in this time had very basic educations. They were expected to help nurture and sustain life. They were not expected to be rabbis. Well, Jesus knew that Mary could understand what he had to teach and show about God and humankind, just like all of the male disciples. He knew that she could do the kinds of things that Jesus did. That's what he wanted his disciples to do. And he knew that she could be a disciple. And for a moment, Mary was included into this new thing that God was doing in and through Jesus. And not only was she a part of the movement, part of this community, she was a leader in this community. She was helping the world and all the people in it live into God's dream of the earth looking just a little bit more like heaven. And then, all at once, Jesus was betrayed and arrested. He was executed and buried. It appeared to be all over. Can you imagine the grief, the heartbreak, and the despair? The male disciples could at least be fishermen again, right? They didn't seem so bothered. They just went back home. They're like, all right, well, we did that thing, now it's on to something else. But what would Mary do? What could she do at this moment but grieve? She had this picture of a new reality, and it appeared like it was gone. She went to Jesus' tomb, the way that we visit the graves of the people that we love. And maybe she went there to cry and to remember everything that Jesus had said to her, everything that he had taught her. Maybe she went to anoint his body with oils and spices. When she arrived, she saw that the stone covering the tomb had been rolled away. And she didn't think, wow, something great has happened. Maybe it's not over after all. No, that's not where her mind went right away. She thought, like any rational person would, that someone had broken into the tomb. She said, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." She didn't believe in life after death. She didn't believe that Jesus had overcome death. The Jewish people believed that people, all people, would be raised at the end of time. But this was not the end of time yet. Our ancient siblings were not foolish. I like to say, you know, they might not have known the periodic table of elements, but they knew that when someone was dead, they were dead. It was over. They weren't foolish. Mary knew that it was over. The only thing that was offering her any comfort was to be with Jesus' body. And now she couldn't even do that. Someone, she's supposed to be the gardener, asks her why she's weeping. And she doesn't hold back. She says, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." She just wants to be near him again. She's desperate just to be with his body. And that's when he calls her by name, by her name, Mary. And she knew immediately it was the one who had called her so long ago and change the course of her life's trajectory. Mary. And I tell you, there is no sweeter sound than the sound of your name, the name that was given to you or the name that you have chosen for yourself. There's no sweeter sound in our brain than our name. And Jesus called her by name. She exclaimed, Rabboni, which means my teacher, my hope, my liberator, my Lord, my everything. She knew that he was back in an unexpected way, and she knew that it wasn't over. Notice, it wasn't through reading scriptures that her hope was restored. She wasn't reading scriptures that morning. It wasn't through believing long enough and hard enough that her hope was restored. She had accepted that he was gone. She wasn't holding out belief that he would be back. It was only when she was called by name that she knew that her hope was not lost. It was through that experience. Jesus called Mary by name that morning, and she knew immediately that everything he had told her was true, that he really was God's anointed one who had come to make all things new. Dear friends, it's this experience of being called by name in and not despite all of our uniqueness and individuality and our unique circumstances and challenges that reassures us that God really is love, that Jesus lives on, and that God's Spirit lives in us now. It's in the moments when we fear that all is lost, the meaning of our lives, the relationships that mean the most to us, our health, our hope, our conviction that our life has purpose and meaning and dignity. It's in these moments that we think everything has been lost and that we are just simply adrift. And then all of a sudden, we hear a name. We hear a voice calling us by name. We hear Jason, Meg, and Karen, Jen, Mo, Jeff, Bob, Stacy. We hear our name, and we know that whatever it is that we think separates us from God and from hope and from a meaningful life can't. Nothing can separate us from the love of God revealed in Jesus. Absolutely nothing, not even death. Mary Hinkle Shore from Lutheran Theological Southern Seminary reminds us of what Jesus said in John 10. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. And that is what he continues doing to this day, calling us by name, by our name, leading us out of the places and the thoughts that make us think that everything is over. It's not over. It's never, ever over, because God loves each one of us. God restores each one of us. God empowers each one of us. I want to close with a final thought this morning, and that's that we don't always recognize the one through whom God may be speaking to us, the one nudging us to new life and to new hope. And Mary didn't recognize Jesus, who appeared as a gardener, until he called her by name. And we don't always recognize the ones through whom God is calling us by name because we think that they are only a gardener, only a senior, only a grocery store clerk, only a barista. For 11 years, only an unhoused woman or man, only a humble person. How could God speak through them, through a humble person? Well, this is the way that God has chosen to work and to speak from the very beginning, through a humble woman and man named Sarah and Abraham at first, and then through God's own son, who trained to be a carpenter, and then through some of his disciples who were actually trained to be fishermen. God is still speaking and still working through all of those who embrace humility and vulnerability. God is always with the humble, always. If we haven't heard our name, our real name, called in a while, I recommend hanging out with some of the dear people through whom God tends to speak. Friends, you are God's beloved. Each one of you, each person here this morning, each person joining from home or the hospital, each person joining the service later, you matter to God. Your hope matters to God. Your life matters to God. And as proof, God knows your name, the name that causes you to light up when you hear it. God knows your name and calls you by name, just like Mary. Amen. Please pray with me. Oh God, we thank you that you have not called humanity abstractly, that you have not called us despite our uniqueness, our individuality, but in it, in our uniqueness, in our concreteness, you call us by name. Sometimes, God, you call us through others. Help us listen for your voice, help us listen for it, even if it is through someone around us, someone near us. Always, God, through someone who has chosen humility and vulnerability. Thank you for calling us by name and leading us. Amen. I invite you to consider sharing a gift that will continue supporting and strengthening this congregation, that will allow us to continue calling people in our community by name. There are plates by all of our exits. You may also donate online through our secure server. You can also email a check-in the old-fashioned way. Your faithfulness, your generosity allows us to be the voice and the presence of unconditional love for all people in our community. I have a habit of making large donations to a wonderful group called Slow for Home. They help relocate refugees all over the world here to the Central Coast, and I am determined never to break that habit. I made another $500 donation to Slow for Home to help folks get to safety, live in our beautiful community. And it is your giving that makes that possible. So I thank you for your faith and your great faithfulness.
Oh,
surprise us again, faithful God, with your ability to turn these offerings into gifts that will transform the world through our witness to your love. Amen.
Buried there for too long. Now I come alive in the one who has conquered it all.
Walked out of my grave clothes and I came out in a new robe. I was buried there for too long. Now I come alive in the one who has conquered it all. Walked out of my grave clothes and I came out in a new robe. I was buried there for too long.
Song. So hard. Sorry. While everyone is still standing, I invite everyone to join me in an affirmation of faith, and that will be the prayer of St. Francis. You're welcome to join me in praying, Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. where there is darkness, light, where there is sadness, joy. O divine master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, and it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we have borne to eternal life. Amen. You're invited to stick around for Nosh over in our fellowship hall. We have some quiche, we have some baked goods, we have fruit salad, green salad, we have cupcakes from Terry and Michael, cute little bunny cupcakes. Please be our guests. The whole hall is ready for you, and there's seating outside if we need outside seating. Thank you for being here to celebrate this special, special day. I invite everyone to pay close attention to your bulletin. There's so much great stuff going on in our community. I want to highlight a couple of things. Tomorrow night is Opening Doors of Interfaith Understanding. And that is a group that is so dear to my heart. Friends from the Muslim, Jewish, Christian, and Buddhist communities come together, and we learn about each other, our traditions, our scriptures, and we actually develop friendships, which is wonderful. And we break bread together. So everyone's invited. It's at First Pres on Monday night, and it's also on Zoom. We sent the link out in Friday's email. Also, there's still opportunities to get involved with People's Kitchen this month. And then lastly, the church office is closed tomorrow. Yeah. Debbie and Christy and I ain't gonna be here. So please stay home, for real. Everyone, Christ the Lord is risen today. It is a reason to celebrate, to hope, to live with joy and purpose. And now, as people who have been renewed and restored, go into this world, sharing God's peace and love always. Amen.